thank you all for coming. It's a packed room. We're happy to see that. We thought we were competing with lightning talks, and that sounds exhilarating. So thanks for coming to have what I hope is going to be a productive and hopefully a slightly controversial discussion on export controls of surveillance technology. So I'm going to briefly introduce the session now. My name is Lucy. I'm a policy associate at Access Now. I work on issues like cybersecurity, export controls, surveillance, data retention, all that fun stuff. If you don't know Access Now, check us out. You heard one of my colleagues earlier. And if you're staying for CPDP, you'll hear a lot more of us. So I'm going to introduce a little bit the framing kind of for this panel, then I'll introduce my panelists, and then I'll hand it over to them to make, let's say, 10-minute interventions. I'm going to be a little flexible if you want to do less or more. It's up to you. And then we'll open it up to you guys, and hopefully not just to ask questions, but also to bring in your perspective. So if you heavily disagree or agree, shout it at us. We want to hear it so that it's productive. So in September 2016, and kind of the inspiration for this panel, the European Commission proposed an overhaul of the EU export controls. Now, for those unfamiliar, export controls are a tool, basically a trade tool, that we can use to kind of restrict the flow of certain technologies. Basically, the idea here is that there will be a human rights kind of weighing mechanism of what can be exported to other countries. This is really important because even though there have been human rights kind of qualifiers in export controls legislation in the past, this is kind of the first time that it's shifted from a human security dimension where it was weighed against very obvious military and defense threats to a more nuanced human rights framework. So now the weighing mechanism is more about the human right to privacy and the freedom of expression. So that's a nuanced shift perhaps, but it's really important in terms of what that's going to mean for certain categories of technology. So in the EU we have this new legislation. Some of us who work on it have an issue with some of the definitions that have been laid out or have not. And the question is, how do we make sure those definitions at the same time allow us to have a very useful tool, but at the same time not restrict, proper research and the transfer of technology as we would have it, in order to facilitate innovation and kind of information exchange around the globe. So it's a really tricky balance. Europe is kind of spearheading this. So the question is also, are we doing the right thing? And how is this actually going to translate for the end users? So some of the things that I want the panelists to discuss is, their experience with export controls and also other basically human rights frameworks in trying to control the spread of surveillance technology. Some of the things this is going to mean for the end users, or if it's going to be meaningless, is this political posturing for the EU more than, a results-oriented tool? We'll try to map out the situation, basically see what tools are out there, what works, what doesn't, and what we can push for here in the EU to have an effective mechanism. I will introduce my panelists. I have Ellen Desmet here from University Ghent and the Human Rights
Integration Network.
Perfect, thank you, HRI Network. Then we have Joshua Franco from Amnesty International, Walter van Holst from say it.
Vrijschrift.
Thank you. And Renata Villa from the World Wide Web Foundation joining us. So a nice, I think, diverse amount of opinions. And Renata, if I can throw it to you to kick us off.
Yes, thank you for having me here. Just a first thought on this. I think that the process of the discussion of this regulation in Europe was the most successful part of exposing many decision makers to the problem and letting them learn what is all about these technologies, how those technologies can be used in harmful ways, and the proliferation of these technologies everywhere, and how those technologies were produced in Europe. It was a very, very positive process that involved many stakeholders and diverse opinions. However, I think that it is one of these feel-good but not so effective at all policies in Europe, because if I consider the situation of my country and the situation of other countries in Central America, I mean, politics matter, and when the European Union decides to choose which country is a human rights violator and which country is an ally helping us to combat terrorism, to combat the war on drugs, and to combat this or that, whichever noun that they use as enemy, then we are in trouble. And it's a very concrete thing. And if I look back into history and the embargoes and the restrictions imposed in export of military equipment to Guatemala, Salvador, Honduras, and so on, I mean, armies and governments are resourceful, and so they can easily circumvent these kind of restrictions. And at the end of the day, what will, for example, if Guatemala is considered a country violating human rights by the European Union, which is not, and it is, basically what Guatemala will do is to knock at the door of China, get it cheaper, get it even more pervasive than that, and even it will be like even more obscure. I mean, it's not creating an incentive not to buy it, or I mean, at some point can expose the intention of a country not to buy from European providers, and Europe can feel good that, okay, a European company at least is not providing it. But I mean, even European companies can create, like the corporations and the way the corporations function today are no longer like grounded to a EU jurisdiction anymore. I mean, and in the case of, you can create a sister company in China, have a completely secret sharing everything and provide exactly the same software. That's one of the problems. In Guatemala, to go back to the story of my country, basically when the no European country and US couldn't sell us weapons, we got the weapons from the Israeli. And basically the connection was even made by the governments trying to restrict the technologies. That's one point. The other is also, the problem that we have to tackle here is the reduction of this proliferation of industries, and by artificially restricting just the supply to certain countries, we are just doing a look good, feel good policy, I think. And again, we have this duplicity in the discourse, so it is completely all right that a European Union country, UK, just passed the most abusive and horrendous law and can spy not only on their citizens but on everyone, but a European the European Union decides that this country cannot do the same that they are doing anyway. And it also places, it consolidates surveillance power somehow, and it gives the monopoly of the decision of who is authorized to exercise the surveillance and who isn't on a foreign country. And then we have again a clash on double discourse on free trade, but restrictions on some trade, but some human rights violations, but no, but you can still produce our these products and sell it to us. But it is a mess. I think that it's sending very mixed messages. It's somehow colonialist at some point, and it is arbitrary. I think that a clear example, Central American countries just signed a free association agreement with the European Union. The human rights clause was completely removed out of it, but then they want to create these artificial patches that are very far away from a comprehensive human rights policy. So in my opinion, it doesn't make much of a difference. It removes actually, if I'm a lawyer, as a lawyer, if I want to sue a hacking team, for me it's convenient that an Italian company is selling this terrible thing to my government and not a Chinese company. I don't know how to sue. I don't know the laws in China. I don't know the mechanisms to hold them accountable. I mean, the more deluded that are these providers, the more removed the ability from me to take action in the relevant venues. And from my perspective, it is more convenient to just tackle the problem as a whole and not just put this patch that will have unintended negative consequences.
Great, thank you. That's quite the statement at the beginning. So the kind of message, and I'm not going to intervene just yet, but the kind of message is, you know, is it kind of meaningless if we're removing human rights clauses, you know, elsewhere, so that we have this patchwork, but at the same time, the European system works in a way that it does provide some kind of redress and traceability, right?
Well, just three points for me is cosmetic.
Mm-hmm.
It might have effects that we haven't even considered. It is not tackling the issue of proliferation of surveillance technologies. It's not improving, it is susceptible to arbitrary labeling of a country as human rights violator and that you cannot use this technology while others can by European views that are not immune from politics. And that's not ideal for this space. But it is good in the sense that it educated politicians to understand more about this.
Right, okay, cool. Thank you for your contribution. And then we'll move to, I think, Joshua,
okay. If
you don't mind.
Sure. My computer is working very hard to save my notes, so I can't see them. So I want to talk a bit about human rights and surveillance. That was sort of my intro, you know, basically what are we talking about when we talk about human rights and surveillance a bit. Coming after Renata's points, it may sound a bit out of place, I see. So I don't want to sort of address that, nor could I necessarily address all of what she said with this talk, but I also don't want to come across as I'm just hammering the harm as if we're all unaware of that. Won't somebody think of the children kind of argument? That's not my point, but I do think it's important.
Hammer a little bit.
I do think it's important to spend some time with what that harm looks like and what we're really talking about here. So before I talk about why I do, you know, and why Amnesty does support the EU proposal, well, we support the process anyway, I think it's useful to make at least one distinction at the outset, which is when we talk about the regulations or the proposal that was put forward in September, it's often, I find people tend to talk past each other a little bit about whether we're talking about what we could call actually existing export regulations or the regulations we aspire to have. So there are many valid criticisms that can be made and that we've in fact made of the existing regulations, but we aspire to make those a bit stronger. So I'll just put that out there as my one caveat for now and maybe return to that at the end. So really briefly, what we're trying to do over the last year or two at Amnesty is look at what surveillance means in human rights terms. And what I've looked at a couple of countries, I did some work in Belarus, and I have some work forthcoming in Uzbekistan that provides some examples of sort of what surveillance does to activism, what it does to free speech, and what we're up against. And when we talk about this stuff, it's not, you know, the GCHQ and the NSA tools and all of that are the coolest toys out there, but a lot of governments can get by with these sort of off-the-shelf solutions. One guy in Belarus that I spoke to made the point, and Belarus is a big country, but it's about 10 million people only, and he said, you know, look, if you want to keep every dissident, every opposing voice in Belarus under surveillance, you only need to look at about 100 people. And he was exaggerating slightly, but the point is you don't necessarily need an NSA GCHQ type solution to have a really repressive surveillance system. And what Belarus has, as a caveat, not all of these things are tools that would necessarily come under the regulation or come from Europe or any of that, but it's just an example. Both mass and targeted surveillance that happens in Belarus happens through a system called SORM, which is common to a lot of post-Soviet countries. And what that does is it allows the authorities to tap directly into the communications networks of your phones and your internets without any supervision. They have direct remote control access 24 hours a day. They don't really need to show anyone a warrant, and the legal grounds for doing this are so broad that basically anyone could be subject to surveillance at any time. And it's also a pretty repressive legal environment to be an activist in. If you hold an unauthorized protest, if you receive foreign funding for an unregistered NGO, there's a lot of things that are we would consider legitimate exercise of your human rights that can land you in jail there. So to be an activist is pretty fraught, and you have to worry about this. And there's a general assumption across the board that public spaces, your off and private spaces, your offices, your homes, your cars, streets, cafes, these are not safe spaces to have conversations. And I had people tell me that again and again. There was an incident when I was there of three opposition politicians in a cafe who opened up their napkin holder and found it had some really primitive bugging device into it. And it's just sort of everywhere, this constant threat of surveillance. And that makes it nearly impossible to operate. If you want to organize a meeting, you basically have to leave your phone at home, obviously, go meet someone in person, and arrange to have a further meeting in person if you want to do anything like hold a protest or something like this. So it just becomes cumbersome and difficult to the point of being nearly impossible, and it's really keeping people out of the public discourse in a way that shouldn't happen. And then, of course, you can also be targeted, so that's the general sort of chilling effect environment. But what happens when this data is used against you? So one example, I met a young activist that I called Ivan because he didn't want to use his real name. He's a student activist at the university. He had an experience where he was called into the administrator's office after he'd organized some protests and things, and the administrators were there with some people. He didn't know who they were, but he assumed they're KGB because that's the assumption that most people operate on. And they said, look, we've got your private messages from your VK account, which is Russian social media account. We know you're gay, so we're going to out you unless you start informing on your fellow activists, and we're going to kick you out of the university, and then who knows what happens. Maybe you'll be recruited into the army, yada, yada, yada. And Ivan, to his infinite credit, told him where to stick it, but he had a lot of problems because of that. He did get kicked out of university, and he suffered tremendously for his courage in that situation. Another case was a guy named Leonid Sudolenko. If there's any Belarusians in the room, please feel free to correct my pronunciation. But Leonid Sudolenko is an activist from Homol, and he's been an activist for decades. He's very well known and respected. He had a situation where his personal email account was compromised twice. He called tech support, got it back open, yada, yada, yada. Didn't think much about it. A few months later, he's out traveling, and he gets a call from his wife saying, come home, come home. The cops are here and they're ransacking the apartment. They're looking for drugs and pornography. And, you know, he didn't know what that was. He was out of the country, but he came home. He was worried about his teenage son, and maybe, you know, they were suspecting him of being involved in drugs or something. And he got there, and it turns out someone had sent pornography from his email account directly to the prosecutor's office, and I think the tax authorities, which is a criminal offense in Belarus, and go to jail for that. So it would have been monumentally stupid for him to do that if he did, which he didn't. And he, in the end, you know, ended up being protected in some sense by his reputation, in the sense that a lot of national and international human rights groups came to his defense and made a lot of noise, and it became, he believes, that is what prevented him ending up in jail over that. So if you're operating in these contexts, surveillance is a very real threat day to day. Have I talked too long? I've got other examples. Uzbekistan, same situation. There they use, we know from Privacy International, they're using American and Israeli monitoring centers there, as well as, we all know, they bought everyone's favorite hacking tool, Hacking Team. And what that does, I mean, I spent some time talking to Uzbekistani refugees in Europe about how that impacts on their rights in Europe, even though the surveillance is going on inside of Uzbekistan. And it came up almost incidentally in speaking to someone about this issue that she hadn't called her family in Uzbekistan in 17 years, hadn't spoken to them because of this fear of surveillance, that people are afraid the cops will come knocking on your door the next day. And targeting also happens. There's a journalist based in Berlin who runs an independent news website, and you know, she had secret sources inside the country because it's illegal to work for a foreign news organization without the permission of the Ministry of, I believe, Foreign Affairs. And you can be prosecuted for that. And if you're working secretly and you're not reporting your income, you can be prosecuted for tax evasion. So people have to keep their identities secret. And those identities were exposed when her email was hacked in Berlin. And those names of her sources ended up on a government-affiliated website in Uzbekistan, and those people were threatened with prosecution and had to flee with their families and leave their country behind. So this is what's at stake when we talk about surveillance, and it's everywhere. And taking Renato's point, it's definitely happening in Europe too. We're not blind to that. We know that Amnesty has been targeted by GCHQ in the UK. We know they've intercepted our communications. We had a ruling from the IPT, which is this sort of a pseudo-court that looks over surveillance practices in the UK, wherein we brought a case with a bunch of other organizations globally challenging international data sharing. And there was a ruling, they won't tell you if they've spied on you, but they will tell you whether they spied on you and broke their own rules. So we got a ruling against, I think, the 7 of the plaintiffs saying, no violation, we might have intercepted you, but if we did, it was within the rules. And one organization, the Egyptian Initiative for Personal Rights, we did break our own rules there. We kept the data longer than we should have. Go home. A few days later, Friday evening, we get an email. Sorry, guys, there was one typo in that judgment. When we said Egyptian Initiative for Personal Rights, we actually meant Amnesty International, but the rest of the judgment stands. So off you go. Have a nice weekend. So we know that happened, and we're working against that. I mean, we are involved in litigation against mass surveillance and other unlawful surveillance practices in Europe at the same time. But it's also, you know, it's global. We were targeted by a really bizarre campaign from a fake NGO this summer. One of our workers on Qatar and migrants' rights there got an email from a woman named Amelie who represented a group called Voiceless Victims. Never heard of them, but they work on migrant rights in the Gulf. Sounds legit. They got a Facebook page with 5,000 followers and a history going back years. They've run major campaigns. They seem legit. But he clicked on something they sent, and it sent him to a really suspicious website that our networks caught, because we're a big organization and we have those resources. And so we had to think, you know, has this organization been compromised? That seems the most likely scenario, because why else would they send us that? Or is it a fake organization? And we started poking around, and it turned out, through a very non-digital investigation, to be the latter. We poked around, and I just want to read this one because it's funny. Started looking at some of the things they posted. This is a post that Amelie put on their Facebook page for Voiceless Victims, saying, as a human rights activist, I've always wanted to visit Africa. Unfortunately, human rights abuses are occurring on a daily basis in that area, and child abuse is one of the most common violations. And so this is what some of the tip-offs we were starting to get. This is my friend characterized it in our write-up as saying, the absurdly non-specific reference to visiting Africa, the stereotype reference to the experience of African children, and the ultimately pointless nature of this posting made us suspicious, which it did. And so we started writing to them, we got some journalists involved, and they wrote us once back, they didn't answer a lot of questions, and eventually we actually sent someone to knock on their door in Lille, and nobody heard of them, the postman never heard of them, their neighbors never heard of them. And as soon as reporters started poking around, their website went blank and they put up a notice saying, Voiceless Victims is under attack, the bad guys have won. So I guess we're the bad guys. What's my point? My point is, this is a huge threat to activists everywhere. So when we talk about human rights and surveillance, I just want to keep us grounded in sort of what we're trying to, what's the evil we're trying to prevent here. Briefly on, you know, why I support this, and I'll leave that mostly to the other two panelists and the questions, that's a debate we can have here. Like I said, you know, there's the existing regs and there's the regs we can hope to achieve. And I think although we're completely clear that this is not going to end the evil that I just described a minute ago in all corners of the world, it is a welcome first step, I think, and it is something that we need to push to strengthen. And where I really want it strengthened in particular is around transparency. And we had a discussion earlier about transparency in another panel, but this is a place where I think it really could help. The UK and Finland do put some of their export license data online. It's not as much as I'd like to see, but there's some up there. And if that were out there for us to scrutinize, if people had to be a bit more public about the risk assessments they're doing and what they're selling to people, then that gives us a lot more information about the powers of those governments, and it gives people in those countries a resource to look at what tools their own governments might be using against them. So I'll pretty much end there, and well, just one more point on the legal framework, which is to say, and I think Ellen's going to speak more about this, is that, you know, the human rights obligation on states and on corporates not to allow their exports to be used for these types of human rights violations is an existing human rights violation. These regulations don't create a new obligation on anyone. They do create certain bureaucratic necessities, but this is a way to implement the human rights due diligence obligation that is binding on companies as part of their international obligation to respect human rights. And this is something that corporates, actors in other sectors have already had to deal with. If you talk to people in the extractives industry or elsewhere, you'll see that they encompass, that they already know about the duty and what it encompasses to some degree, some of them. And it involves, you need to conduct a risk assessment. What are the human rights risks of selling your product? How are you going to mitigate those risks? How are you going to monitor and know what they are? And how are you going to what kind of remediation are you going to offer if things go wrong? And, you know, that is a pre-existing duty that if you were to, for example, find yourself as a corporate actor involved in litigation where someone was claiming your product led to a human rights violation, your business led to a human rights violation, and you have to sit there and say, well, we never did a risk assessment, that's not going to be a good day in court for you. So these regs, you know, go a little bit of the way towards facilitating people engaging in a process that they're legally bound to undertake, and hopefully will be a first step towards remedying some of these problems.
Great. Okay. Thank you so much for the contribution. I think, talking about the kind of real experience with surveillance is important, that grounding. So thank you for that. I guess, Walter, if you want to take it away, speak a bit about the Wassenaar and
yeah.
EU regulation and what we're seeing in terms of the regulatory framework then.
That would be probably yes. May I get a show of hands? Who knows the name Wassenaar? And who knows the name? What those who raise their hands, who of you are familiar with the Wassenaar arrangement? Because Wassenaar is just a suburb of The Hague, so you could just pay incidents. By the way, the secretariat of the Wassenaar arrangement is in Vienna, just in case you might make consider it any sensible. The Wassenaar arrangement is an instrument which has a lower status than a treaty, and it came into being in the early 90s, and it covers so-called strategic dual-use goods. And the primary incentive to get there was basically the Soviet Union and its satellite states had collapsed. There was still a lot of technology around there on nuclear, biological, and chemical warfare. That might be ripe for poaching by other state and non-state actors. And the idea was there was a kind of consensus internationally, at least in the industrialized world, that it would be a good thing to control, not to end up with a bunch of, let's say, ex-Soviet nuclear scientists working for Saddam Hussein. Or that was typical kind of scenario people were thinking about. In the same period, we had the nerve gas attacks in Japan, so everyone was kind of on edge on interesting weapons technologies, which typically tend to have a civil side, civil use as well. So that's where the term dual use comes from. Well, under the Wassenaar arrangement, you have long lists of regulated technologies that varies from cryptography, which from a human rights perspective we rather not have as a control technology. Lots of nuclear technology, biotechnology, all sorts of, well, basically, last time I browsed through the list, I felt, no, I think almost any hackerspace would really love to have this stuff lying around. So it gives Renata's point about the extent to which you can control the technology. There are goods on those lists that I expect to show up in hackerspaces within 10 years, because they come that easily achievable with digital fabrication and so on. But that's the size of it. Basically, this framework more or less functions. But the European Union is not in itself a signatory to Wassenaar. By the way, Wassenaar is mostly non-binding. However, the EU members decided that it will be useful to implement Wassenaar in a fairly uniform way. And that's how the regulation on export controls on dual goods came into being, which basically gave the European Commission the authority to transpose mutations in the lists of Wassenaar into EU binding law through a regulation. And at some point, we also got into the cases like Hacking Team, Gamma International, especially during the so-called Arab Summer, Arab Spring. It was found out that, to a large extent, the surveillance infrastructures of the autocrats in the Middle East were basically supplied by Western, mostly European companies, which raises the question, do we find it acceptable or not? And it was quite widely felt that this was not an acceptable situation. So the Wassenaar arrangement got a new category of goods introduced, so-called cyber surveillance. And whether it is by bad luck or by bad intent, we ended up with a definition of, for example, exploits that are extremely harmful to information security issues. And that has to do with the fact that under this arrangement, in this framework, any information technology is basically just treated as, let's say, uranium enrichment and centrifuges, as it is some fancy high-tech good that you cannot easily reproduce, and which is typically produced in very large top-down hierarchies, whereas information security research is done on a mostly individual basis in very loosely coupled, very international networks. In nuclear technology, you have this notion of intangible technology transfers, which got people prosecuted for having Chinese students in a class on nuclear physics in the past in the United States. That is literally an intangible technology transfer, giving a lecture on nuclear physics with students of the wrong nationality in your class. So if you apply that to information security, where everyone is continuously sharing information over the internet, this is problematic. So that is one human rights perspective. From a freedom of expression perspective, the Washington arrangement is very problematic, which gets us back to the current proposal for the European Union regulation, which does not address that, but at least introduced additional safeguards that may or may not be useful. And the debate we are right now having within civil society is, do we actually accept this process? Do we actually accept this approach? What kind of safeguards do we find we're fighting for? How can we take out the pain of Wassenaar, or is it pointless altogether, as Renata more suggested? And I will just end this intervention with just giving my opinion on that. I don't really care whether this kind of services are available from, let's say, China, Belarus, or Russia. I think if you're a company that benefits from the openness of a democratic society of the rule of law, or whatever remains of it in the current situation, but by and large still enjoying a situation that gave you the people with the knowledge, the access to the technology, you should not benefit from that situation and at the same time suppress any attempt at more openness in societies elsewhere. And if that forces the Guatemalan government to talk to the Chinese, so be it. That is my personal opinion on this. I think we should give the baton to Emma.
I think only mildly controversial there with your last statement about a democratic society and its responsibilities. But yeah, that's a really interesting question, and that's a really interesting point that Renata brought up as well, is you know, how there is some kind of possibility of redress and traceability, from a European company, whereas once they start talking to China, everything kind of disappears. And it was highlighted also by you guys, you know, we don't have a good enough insight right now into kind of export controls and all the things that pass from Europe. So, you know, if we're leading on this, that's troublesome for the global situation. So Renata is up next, and I'm hoping you can discuss a bit of the...
Sorry, Ellen.
I'm sorry.
You can go twice.
I fear I have over-caffeinated today, so I apologize. That's not for me being sleepy, that's me having too much caffeine in my blood. Perfect. Ellen, please take it away and hopefully talk a little bit about the human rights framework and the end user experience, and again, going back to this kind of idea of redress and what does it mean for the humans on the ground.
Okay, thank you for the invitation. I'm coming in here from a general human rights background, so I want to start with a disclaimer that I'm not familiar with surveillance technologies and so on, but I was asked to present some perspectives that we developed in a research project on human rights integration from users' perspective. So these are two points I first want to tackle: on what does a user's perspective on human rights imply, and what does an integrated approach to human rights mean? And then lastly, I want to talk a little bit of, okay, if we have companies that are violating their human rights of people in other countries by exporting such technologies, what can we do now within the human rights legal framework, and what are the possibilities and especially the limits today of this human rights framework? And can I start by maybe asking who of you, if there are many lawyers here, because it kind of changes a bit.
Hence higher a little bit, because I can kind of see them from my
one third. Okay, so
admit to it.
Don't be ashamed, I'm a lawyer as well. It happens. So first of all, I mean, the term users has already fallen here, but more in the sense of users of technologies. I think it also makes sense to talk about using human rights. Who is using human rights? Who is invoking human rights? And how do they engage with human rights? And in this sense, if you think from that perspective, because mostly we study human rights, so okay, we're gonna look at the right to privacy, or what does the European Court of Human Rights says about that article, or how does that convention work? But if we look at it from a user's perspective, if we take a kind of empathic approach of a certain person, institution, and so on, the perspective changes. Then you are confronted with all kinds of human rights norms, because they're not like, you cannot say from, okay, give me the catalog of human rights. There are many different instruments in which human rights are enshrined, binding, non-binding at the European level, inter-American, African, United Nations. There are general human rights instruments, there are specific human rights instruments or certain topics of torture on specific categories of people. So if you look at it from a user's perspective, you immediately have this kind of, you're confronted with this complexity of the multi-layeredness of human rights, that there's not one human right, but you have different interpretations also given by different actors. And it makes sense to try to, you know, use all these different interpretations and be aware of them and not only focus on one. And also you can make a distinction between different types of users. The most important users, you could say, or the supposed beneficiaries of human rights would be the direct users, the rights claimants, those who invoke that their human rights are being violated. Then another type of direct user would be the rights realizers, those who are realizing human rights. In principle, the states are the primary duty bearers of human rights law, but you could also have individuals, organizations, and so on, who actually really want to realize human rights in a specific situation. On the other side of the scheme, you have what you can call indirect users of human rights, who in a way link up with the direct users. And for example, Amnesty would be a supportive user, who is supporting other people to invoke or to have their rights realized. Also lawyers, human rights defenders, international human rights institutions would be supporting the realization of human rights of others mostly. And then a final category after the rights claimants, the rights realizers, the supportive users would be the judicial users, those who can impose a certain human rights obligation to a state if the European Court of Human Rights says from, okay, you Belgium has violated the right of this or that person. So that's very briefly this user's perspective, which may make sense as if, okay, we're not gonna talk about the right to privacy in general, but what does it mean for journalists in Azerbaijan? And what are the different human rights that are at stake? Not only right to privacy and freedom of expression, but maybe also freedom of religion, maybe also right to non-discrimination, because maybe he's put under surveillance because of his membership of a particular ethnic or cultural community, or because he is disabled or not, and so on, so that you take all these human rights into account. And that you also look, because now if we look at the mechanisms that are in place to enforce human rights or to look if human rights are complied with, they're often also focused on a specific team. The European Court of Human Rights is mostly focusing on civil and political rights. They have brought in economic, social, and cultural rights. You know, the Committee on the Rights of the Child will primarily deal with children's rights. But it would make sense if all these actors and also people on the ground and organizations working on human rights would take an integrated approach and not focus too much on one right, but try to see for one person how do these different rights come into account, also from a perspective of intersectionality, where different identities and or different aspects of your identity intersect, and that can actually lead to a greater violation of your human rights than only one aspect. So that was a bit apart on the user's perspective and integrated approach. I don't know, try to make sense of it for you within your specific working context, if it makes sense at all. The last point is that if we look at this issue of exporting surveillance technologies, what can we do from a human rights law perspective? And then we are confronted with a very basic weakness of the human rights law system, that states are the primary duty bearers. They are the ones that subscribe to their human rights obligations. They are the ones that are being primarily accountable. And in a way, corporations for now are not the primary duty bearers, and but we have seen an evolution within a mostly soft law, human rights soft law, I would say, towards trying to conceptualize, trying to make these human rights obligations for corporations more concrete. Are you familiar with the RAGI framework? Does it make sense to go? Yeah, so maybe first to say that there was a first another norms on transnational corporations, where there was actually a proposition to say that corporations should have the same range of obligations as to human rights as states, but that proposal was not accepted by states and corporations because they thought it would go too far. And then in the framework proposed by RAGI, the special representative that was appointed to discuss this issue of human rights obligations of transnational corporations, there was actually made a distinction between the duty of the state to protect and the responsibility of the company to respect. So in that sense, you know, this wording of difference makes it clear that they didn't want to go as far for the companies as for the state, that there's a responsibility, but the real legal obligation is within that framework still a bit lacking behind. Possibly the good news is that there has been an intergovernmental working group established to work on a treaty that would be a legally binding instrument on the obligations of human rights and transnational corporations. So that could be a useful tool also within this context, if it happens, because there have only been two meetings up to now with very constructive discussions and so on, but nothing really coming out of it in a concrete way. So that could be an interesting tool. Also, you have other kinds of non-binding human rights instruments like the OECD guidelines, where you have national contact points, and they have actually also already taken some action in the context of the export of surveillance technologies, where, for example, there was a consortium of NGOs led by Privacy International who filed a complaint with national contact point of the UK against a company that was exporting technologies to Bahrain, and then there was a process of mediation which failed. There were recommendations. So there are non-binding procedures to try to sensitize at least these corporations to their human rights obligations. They remain non-legally binding, but they can have effect as to naming and shaming, as to financial investors maybe wanting to retract from investing in that company, government that will decide to leave them behind. So you can have some consequences, even though from a strictly legal perspective, it remains a non-binding procedure. So these were some of the points I was thinking about in this
Brilliant.
Context.
And I don't think detached at all. In fact, I think that's a really important framework for us to think about. And this is, you know, in a way, this is exactly what you mentioned as a very streamlined kind of part of human rights. You know, when you speak about the courts that focus on certain things, here we are just talking about technology. So question is, do we lose out on a bit of a more holistic approach? And, you know, are we addressing just a tool rather than addressing this kind of crisis of democracy that might be happening in that country? And that's a definite issue. So thank you for that. Thank you very much. I think it was a very useful overview. So I will open it up to the floor, I think, at this point, if anyone has questions or brilliant hands already shooting up or opinions. As I said, you can either direct a question or, you know, just state kind of your take if you've been dealing with this or you have experience on the ground. We're willing to hear it. So please, and if I can just ask if you can say your name and maybe affiliation, if you're comfortable with that. That's
Hi, Georg. I don't have a specific affiliation. I used to work with a group named Telecomics a few years ago that we helped Syrians circumvent surveillance and censorship that was performed by the Assad regime. I'll try to organize a bit my thoughts because I have mixed thoughts and feelings about all this. I cannot disagree that we should try to restrict. That is not a good thing that a company sells obviously big equipments to, say, Gaddafi or other dictators that are definitely meant to put the whole population under surveillance. I'm just not sure about whether the method of export control is valid. I'm really unsure, and some questions I have around this. So, for instance, if you take what was present in Syria, the equipment that was in the Syrian regime infrastructure, there were blue coat proxies and Fortinet firewall equipment. They're not meant specifically to be surveillance equipment. It's not their primary use. They can be used as such, but it's not what they're meant for, and I'm pretty sure they were not initially sold for that purpose, for not knowing me. So an example of a problem that can arise here is that if a country is classified as being a bad country, a terrorist country, whatever, then we may simply end up blocking their purchase of network equipment on the grounds of this might be used for surveillance, because most of these equipments can be used for surveillance. So we might actually end up hampering potentially the development of the internet in those countries, for instance. I don't know. And the other point is simply, isn't the current, like, before the transaction happens and before the wrongdoing happens, it seems to me it's very difficult to say anything. And the chances that we're going to do mistakes are high. What about using what the law maybe allows already, which is, for instance, in Libya, there's the French company Amesis that sold these appliances to spy on the whole population. There was a court case. I don't know how it ended, but I don't know if it's ended or I don't know if it's still ongoing. But at least when the harm is done, it's sad, but when the harm is done, you have the proof, you can have the proof that, you know, the crime has been committed, and then you can accuse of complicity of, you know, crime against humanity or torture. So my question is kind of like, should we really try to prevent the crime? Is this really what we want? Isn't this really going to actually not harm more than improve things?
Okay, thank you. I think that was a very cohesive ramble in the end. So thanks, that was really good. And that's, you know, that's in a way, I'm going to let the panelists answer because I'm a moderator here, not a speaker. So Walter, if you want to take that away, and then if anyone else is.
Few things about blocking the development of internet in those countries. The current regime for export controls and also the proposed regimes involve licensing schemes. So basically, you would have to apply for a permit for certain countries. And it's kind of multiple layers. The exporters are supposed to perform due diligence themselves, to just not blindly accept any orders, but also take a look into them and may this affect human rights. And in case of doubt, they would have to apply for permits, and there probably will also be still lists of countries you would have to apply for permits anyway. And in that permit process, and that will be the innovation Lucy during her initial interview, that is the innovation in the proposed regulation, that this permit process also would involve an assessment of potential for human rights violations. And it's an entirely different question whether an ISP is asking for, let's say, fairly fancy routers, or whether an intelligence service is procuring them. You will typically know that as a supplier or as a reseller of that equipment. And while I have massive doubts about the extent to which this can be made effective if you focus on the equipment, I think it's much more interesting to focus on the services. But if you look, I at least understand why this is so enticing to policymakers. If you look at the other proliferation controls which are permits-based, as in for nuclear technology, for biological warfare, etc., by and large it has worked. So apparently we have prevented nuclear proliferation, among other things, through a various set of treaties, plus restriction on the flow of very closely related to the nuclear technology. So, as in, can we actually prevent things from happening? I think the answer will be a tentative yes. Question is, the other question then should be asked, if we prevent bad things from happening, aren't we preventing more good things from happening? And what way do we, and won't that depend on the way we try to prevent the bad things from happening?
Can
I hear your hesitation, and I think this goes to maybe the regulations that we want to see too. I mean, I do understand, and I share, you know, on a personal level, to echo a bit what Renata was saying. When I first heard that this was an initiative taking place to put export controls on surveillance equipment, I wasn't working in this space at that point. I just said, really, the UK and the US care about violating privacy via surveillance hypocritical much? I do get that. But we do have these legal standards that take place, and I think it would be a mistake to allow the human rights language that's made its way into the proposal to rest on this idea of bad countries, like we said. I don't think that's a useful way to think about end users or human rights implicated by this. We have fairly elaborated standards of what constitutes an abuse linked specifically to surveillance that I think we should bring into this. And some of this comes from the European Court or the Court of Justice. So if you look at, for example, the Zakharov judgment from the Grand Chamber of the European Court of Human Rights, I use that judgment a lot in my research on Belarus because they have a very similar system there. And they adumbrated a list of standards about what makes surveillance lawful and what makes it unlawful from a human rights point of view. And it had to do with each of these things. Are people notified? Is the legal framework such that there are legitimate grounds for targeting people? Do the authorities have direct access, or is it mediated somehow? Is there a requirement of a warrant? Is it overseen by a court? All those things. So I would like to see that kind of standard put into this regulation and saying, you know, when assessing your recipient country, look at things like, what is their legal system governing surveillance? Is that hypocritical? Is that looking to impose standards on countries outside the EU that are not being followed in the EU? That's a way to look at it. But I would argue it's an obligation on primarily countries that are members to that actual court to implement those standards in their own countries, and that's something we want to see done. There are a lot of programs going on in Europe right now that violate those standards, that are out of sync with how I read European law on this question. So I think there are ways to make that determination a bit more nuanced. In terms of the risk of mistakes, it's not about infallibility or preventing every harm. I mean, the risk assessment process is something that companies ought to be undertaking regardless, as I said earlier. And when you look at risk assessment, it may be that there are risks, and there may be measures you look at it and say, well, that's a risk we can mitigate by doing X, Y, and Z. Be that selling to one group, not to another portion of the government, being it sending some technician to oversee it, getting guarantees, checking in on it, whatever it is. I'm not going to give a recipe for it, but the point is, you have to do the thinking on what the harms might be and how you might mitigate them. And if you're wrong, there's still a question of what good faith efforts were made to mitigate that. Not everything is preventable, but a lot of things are. And the fact that some things aren't should not be a reason not to try. I don't think we should make this sort of a race to the bottom in that sense where, because the perfect solution is potentially impossible, we don't take the steps that seem doable.
Brilliant, thank you. I hope that answers your question. If not, you can raise your hand in a bit. I'm gonna give other people a chance. First of all, here in the front row, and then.
Okay. My question is if it wouldn't be better to go against features in general, not export control, but to say bad techniques should not be developed at all, or something like that, because you never know who is the next government, you never know who is stealing this technology from one and another. So I think it's in some points you should look at blacklisting certain technologies, certain kinds of surveillance at all.
Sorry, can I ask your name and affiliation if you're comfortable disclosing?
I'm Tobias from Germany, Datenschutzraum e.V., small privacy NGO.
Great, thank you. And so maybe we'll take Malik as well, and then.
I think the censorship issue needs to be discussed in two separate domains. One is the ordinary censorship, that is blocking mechanisms, but it used to be circumvented easily by the VPNs and Tors. But last year, particularly last year, there have been a breakthrough, as far as I understand, in blocking the VPNs and Tor mechanisms. So that seems to be more important from the activist's point of view. Tor and VPNs are quickly becoming a luxury enjoyed only in the Western countries, not in developing countries. So I think the technical community needs to think about it. The Tor people and the technical community need to think about it, because it doesn't work. It simply doesn't work in most of the developing countries now.
Hmm. Interesting. Okay, so we have two questions here. Do we have any responses?
I think it was a chance first.
Yeah. Maybe I like the idea of bad technology here and should be prevented from being developed. No, I guess you will have the most to say.
Trying to keep it low. Basically, we're talking about dual use technologies here, and even this, unless you don't believe in any form of lawful interception, which may be a valid approach. If you don't believe in a role for the state to begin with, then there's no such thing as valid interception. No such thing as lawful interception. But that aside, there is still a role for, at least I'm not one of those, so I think law enforcement being able, given the right safeguards, like Josh set out, to intercept certain communication as part of an investigation into serious crimes, well, that is an interception, that is a surveillance technology. And it would not be, I would not advocate a policy that will blacklist that kind of capability a priori. I'm not in favor of blacklisting technology a priori anyway. But I suppose others may have possibly different views.
I want to say that kind of unites the first question we have and yours. You know, the nature of dual use technologies, it's inherently, you know, the same thing that can be used for good and, you know, just maintaining system functionality and kind of, you know, information security in general can also, in different hands, be used, you know, to violate human rights. So it's very difficult to put a kind of moratorium. And I think that's kind of what Renata suggested as well in her talk. You know, it's prevent these technologies from being developed in a way is it better, and you can maybe jump in if you want to add a little. You know, it might be a more interesting step than trying to prevent their spread. But that's a very tricky narrative, and you know how, and then you would essentially just cripple research and innovation in trying to go down that road. And that's the tricky thing with dual-use technology. It's not a tangible, clear-cut thing, you know, that does just the one task, you know, with the one functionality. There's no off button to turn off the evil in a computer. Technology is inherently neutral, right? Which is why the EU regulation and Wassenaar in a way and all these things that consider the end user and who exactly is being sold to and for what exactly, as Walter pointed out, there's a very big difference in a telecommunications company purchasing it and an intelligence agency. These are the things you have to consider, and that's kind of what the regulation is pressuring export controls authorities as well as the companies to prove. You know, what is, are you seeing where this ends up, and have you considered the implications of those hands that it's ending up in? But if you have a different, more proactive solution, bring it over. Great. I don't know if you look like you have something to say, but
very quickly. So I had the opportunity to give some advice to a tiny government, of a tiny, tiny, tiny under-resourced government, and some of the things that can be achieved as well is to get closer to the people with this idea that these kind of technologies will offer magic solutions. And basically, this tiny little banana republic government, they wanted to be the NSA. They had like big hopes, you know, and aspirations. They thought that they had, I mean, they didn't even have the capacity to control the cameras that they had deployed everywhere in the city. I mean, no effective reduction of crime of this on a small city of under 1 million inhabitants. And they wanted to deploy this system, which is very cheap to buy, very expensive to implement and make an effective use of. And I was like, guys, I mean, like, first, you cannot compete with your political opponents. I mean, they will have better resources on these kind of operations. Second, I mean, what you are doing is just the wrong approach, because I mean the approach for the small actors and the small governments is more of if they are antagonistic to powers that are trying to harm them. I mean, their best defense is have very strong security, and that's where I don't see the conversation going. I mean, it is very cheap to spy on everyone, because it's very, our technology is very cheaply designed in security terms. And I think that re-engineering the global security standards of data protection, making really, really, really hard, and like really, rethinking the way the devices collect data, and practically designed to collect as much data as possible, and to make us as more vulnerable as possible, regardless who we are. And I think that that's another another set of ideas that I think that the European Union could promote and fund. Like, let's, okay, we have at the moment a very insecure and vulnerable environment that makes anyone here or in Belarus or in Cuba or in Argentina or in the US vulnerable to this kind of behavior. And maybe the proactive way, instead of this restriction of one kind of technology, is the better design of all technologies and elevating the standards. I mean, we did it with cars, we did with the pollution, we did with globally in many other fronts. So I'm a little bit, I was finishing an article, I'm fed up of having to stick a sticker on my telephone camera. I mean, that's the most idiotic approach, I think. It just sends the wrong message. The right message will be like, I want to trust my device, and I want to make sure that the institutionality from the state side and from the private sector and from all fronts and from the accountability mechanisms is in place, so I don't have to put the sticker on my camera, basically.
Yeah, that's great. You're nailing a lot of the really core issues of the debate, I think. And one of the things you mentioned is you should promote a secure environment, you know, and that should be the focus. And one of the biggest, you know, some of the biggest criticism that has come from NGOs in general has been, why is encryption still regulated? You know, are we just basically limiting the spread of secure technology? And some people have, in conversations, called that a very proactively deliberate measure, because it's in the interest of a lot of governments to have more insecure networks, because exactly, it is very cheap. And I think that's a frustration that we're seeing emerging in Europe. Now with greater security standards, law enforcement's much more frustrated. It's a lot more costly, and it's much more, it's harder on resources to interfere with technology. But yeah, we're not in a totally secure place. Does anyone want to chime in as well?
Joshua,
no question, I think. Oh, many questions. Okay, Dan will take you, and then, and again, if you guys can say name and affiliation, just so people know who's in the room listening, except for the NSA, obviously.
Yeah, I'm Daniel from Reporters Without Borders, German section in Berlin, and I'm working on the proposal these days as well, as we have a parliamentary hearing on Friday in Germany, and I think. Oh, I'm a bit surprised that you are so happy. For me, it seems that you are quite happy with the proposal. No? Oh, okay.
I won't go that far. But why are you surprised?
Because in your introduction, you said that Amnesty supports the proposal, and we do as well in some points. But I think there's still work to do. And for us, the most important, or one of the most important thing is. The lack of transparency, because we have this kind of shadow market, and nobody knows what these companies did in the past, and this will continue with this proposal. So what I know is that there will be an information exchange between the EU and the member states, but there won't be any statistics, and we, for example, if something happens again, that what's the name, Area, this company in Italy, Area, I think, and the other, that sold to Egypt, I think, this year or last year, when it was obvious that Egypt wasn't a democracy, those cases could happen again, and I think this is something where we have to ensure that this maybe will change in the parliamentary process.
Okay.
And what the question is, do you agree, and what are other points for you that are important to debate now with politicians?
So I think this one was kind of directly to you, so I'll let you defend and answer, and then I'll take others.
So yeah, I did. You're correct to be surprised. That's not my position. I mean, I'm happy that this proposal is happening. I'm happy that there's attention to the human rights implications of some of these surveillance exports. But no, we definitely have recommendations to make. So thank you for that. In that sense, the softball. So let me tell you my recommendations. I totally agree with you on transparency. I mean, if I had one thing to say about it, I would say transparency. As I kind of mentioned a little bit earlier, I think that you know, it's a fair comment. Some people have said, you know, that export regulation authorities and companies are not necessarily set up to do this stuff, which is not really an answer, in my opinion. I mean, get set up. But at the same time, I think it's unrealistic to expect that either the state regulatory authorities or the corporations themselves create a foolproof system. And you're right that as the reg is written, I think there are a lot of, I see a lot of loopholes from my point of view. And I think, you know, some of them, whether or not you could drive a truck through them or whether Hacking Team was a truck, I don't know. But yeah, there are examples of it not working and those need to be closed up. So first of all, I want a more detailed human rights clause, as I mentioned, that takes account of the specific misuses of surveillance technology to abuse human rights rather than just this idea of sort of if there are human rights concerns or internal repression, which really doesn't answer the question. There's internal repression everywhere. Secondly, I mean, I think the way that it's written in terms of some of the obligations, especially regarding what's called the catch-all clause, which is meant to catch technologies that are not listed as part of the list of technologies that are subject to the regulation but could be added if there's a concern. At this point, it's, as I read it, totally optional. States may impose this duty. They may not. May is sort of the operative word there as I read it. And consequently, companies are on their own meant to examine their own products, and if they determine that their product, as I read the proposal, if they determine that their product poses a human rights risk, they should alert the government to please subject them to a licensing process. That sounds optimistic to me. I don't have a lot of faith in that type of self-regulation. I think that needs to be tightened up a bit. But I totally agree with you that I think the take home, the big one, is going to be transparency, because if the corporates and the government aren't going to catch it, then we can. You know, we want to know what's being sold. People in the countries it's being sold to want to know what's being sold. And I think if there's a reasonable effort to put not only the seller, the destination, the money amount, which is what, or rather even the, not in the UK, they just do a category, dollar amount and recipient, pound amount. Then, you know, we want to know more about what actual products we're talking about. We want to have those risk assessments. I mean, why not do your risk assessment as a company? Submit that to an authority and have it go straight onto the website so we can all look at it. And if Amnesty International or whoever else in this room gets a hold of it and says, wait, seriously, you're selling it to country X, they have an abysmal record of targeting dissidents, this risk assessment doesn't pass the smell test, then that's something we can have that debate about. But right now, as you said, it's completely shrouded in secrecy and we don't know what's going on.
Did you want to say something?
Yeah, maybe to complement on this issue of risk assessments, I think we see in other areas as well that there's a very big risk that these assessments, they just become a tick box exercise or a formal thing without really going into the specifics, especially if they're not made public. So in that sense, there should be some external control, or they should not be just done by the company or subcontracted by the person who is a judge and party at the same time. So in that sense, ideally, there should be a kind of independent control mechanism to these risk assessments if they really want to work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a big issue. And just to play defense here, Joshua did say that Amnesty International supports the initiative for this, not that they support the
regulation. I think
we
clarified it now, but thank you.
Just, yes, to reiterate. And, you know, there's two aspects of this regulation, and it's being touched upon repeatedly now. You know, it's one of the issues is proactively, can we prevent the harmful kind of end use of these technologies? But also, you know, it's important for us to have a useful reactive tool. So if we don't have those definitions there retrospectively, I can't go to a company and say you violated, you know, your responsibility, you failed your responsibility to do this kind of assessment and to do your due diligence. They'll be like, well, it's very vague. I didn't know what to do. You know, so there's it doesn't all have to be in just the proactive, reactively. If we have a very strong regulation with very strong definitions, when we do find something like this, you know, it can be used in different ways. So I think that's something to look at. I will take questions. I'm going to give the space to Marianne, ladies first, and then you'll go in the. Yeah.
So hi, my name is Marianne. I am advocacy manager at EDRI. So I had a question, and I guess also everybody would like to know, what are the type of arguments that you face from companies? From the picture that you actually portrayed today, I see that there's a debate inside of the society. Is there an unified industry out there, or are there differences? What about the governments? Do member states have the same approach, or is it too soon to tell? Or what's the challenges that you're seeing?
That's awkward because I think I'm in the best place to answer that. But I feel like I'm talking a lot as a moderator.
Shall I go on a second bit? Or maybe Josh?
Just to say, maybe I can do the companies or the things that I've heard here. Is it a unit? You know, the companies, actually, I think we find ourselves in a very unique, with just speaking about the EU now, you know, we find ourselves in a very unique position where we're on the same page as the companies on a lot of things for vastly like different motivational reasons.
Mm-hmm.
So we want, you know, the commission uses interchangeably human rights violations, serious human rights violations, and extreme human rights violations. You know, there's a lot of vagueness, and it was already pointed out, what is the due diligence, do the impact assessments look like, what is the responsibility on the export controls authorities, which are basically, you know, for those of you who are new, the kind of gatekeepers, right? So the company will submit an impact assessment, but it has to be the state regulator who looks at this. And so without those definitions being locked down, it's a very loose tool for us to use as civil society. But companies find this frustrating because it's a very loose tool for them to find loopholes in. So they're also pushing for better definitions and stronger definitions because they want to have the legal certainty. For some of them, you know, especially the big vocal ones are not actually particularly some of the ones that you want to target with this, and they just want to have like a very strong legal framework. So oddly enough, on some of the issues, we would agree. And the regulation, when you read into it, has simplified a lot of the export process. But anyway, Walter, do you want to chime in?
Yeah, well, there's one massive gift in the regulation. This is something I didn't know before this either, but there are still intra-EU export regulations. So if you're trading in goods that are covered by export regulations, and by the way, the range of goods that are being covered is very wide. For example, the fertilizers industry, they typically use ammonia nitrate, which is an ingredient of explosives as well. They're covered by export regulation. So you end up in a session with people from the fruit industry, because pesticides are precursors to chemical weapons, with people from the fertilizer industry, because they're precursors to explosives, and so on, and the relative newcomers from industry are actually electronics and IT companies. And the big gift that the Commission is giving in this proposal is that the intra-EU regulations are kind of abandoned completely. And industry is by and large very happy with that. So most of the opposition is actually coming from IT and telecoms, because they're the first one. For them this is relatively new. Very vocal are the German industry, because they're already in a situation with the German government actively looking into this. Also very vocal are the Danes, who really don't like any regulation whatsoever. That's a typical takeaway. Other typical things are the catch-alls are very controversial. And another very controversial part of the proposal is that dual goods exports for related to terrorism would be covered. And everyone was like, what do you mean by terrorism? How would we possibly know that the stuff we export is going to be used with terrorism? So that is one of the things. And civil society is not against dropping terrorism altogether out of the regulation. I mean, the whole war on terror stuff typically introduces elements that are not really compatible with the rule of law in a democratic society. So that's another topic on the same side as industry. I don't think industry is that keen on transparency, because that will make their, basically their commerce public. That's something that they will fight tooth and nail against, but they are indeed very much in favor of legal clarity. And at the end of the day, most industries, if they have to choose between clarity and strictness, less strict but more vague, or more clear but more strict, they will still go rather have more clear and more strict than vague and loose. So it's a bit of a difficult landscape in the sense, but it's not an impossible one.
Does anyone want to add on the companies and parties? Okay. Say your name and your.
So I'm Julien from the University of Technology of Compiègne. I have a question which is was inspired by you had this short comment on the question of costs. And so I have a question that I'm curious about, which is there is a research project in France called UTIC, UTIC, which is looking into how intelligence agencies use intelligence techniques and try to open this kind of black box. And one of their conclusions so far was to say that this notion of cost was very important in when they choose to apply a surveillance technique or not, because it can be quite costly. And so, for example, they said that the police is always very happy to have a lot of CCTVs, because even if it is not efficient, at least they do not have to pay for it. So we saw in the Nice attacks that the CCTVs were completely useless in preventing the attack, that there was data about all the terrorists who blew themselves up or killed people and so forth. So basically, you mentioned that Amnesty International was targeted by an attack that was actually seems very low tech. It's human intelligence, it's creating a fake page, cheap spam and phishing. I mean, it's not that cheap because there are 5,000 followers, but I mean, it doesn't seem very high tech. So my question is actually, how effective are these surveillance software, and what are the surveillance softwares that we have to be very wary of and kind of focus our attention at? And what is more like kind of marketing myths that even companies are just telling to state, saying, oh, we're going to do some fancy big data and it's going to be great, but actually it doesn't work and it's perhaps less, I don't know, but it's kind of, perhaps the question isn't very right, perhaps it's not a good question, I don't know, but it's still, curious about the direction.
Interesting.
So,
do we,
I don't know. What's effective? I mean, I think that was a resource-intensive attack this summer with voiceless victims. Just in setting up the organization, it took actual people to do this. I think Amelie and Luke and the other people were, probably were real people. I doubt those were their names, but they were probably doing that. Took hours. I take your point about the efficacy and the cost, and that's a really interesting way to think about it. And there's an argument that a lot of the encryption technology that we're promoting and stuff, it raises the cost of unlawful surveillance. Of course, it probably also raises the cost of lawful surveillance as well. I think it's good that people are starting to become more aware of their digital security across the board, but there's still a long way to go, and there's definitely a divide in between who has those tools and who doesn't. One thing I was thinking about, we had the talk earlier about IoT in this room, and it reminded me that last year the Belarusian telecom, Bell Telecom, signed a deal with Huawei, the Chinese company, to build smart homes. There's going to be 5,000 of them. I wouldn't want to live in that home personally, but maybe 5,000 people will. And so there's going to be a real divide between the privacy technologies available to some and to others. I don't think it takes a super high tech if you have the right adversary. The bug I mentioned in the incident where the Belarusian politicians were chatting in a cafe. Waiter sort of did one of these, like, I know who that is, and then came and took their napkin holder away, which is a perfectly good napkin holder full of napkins, and came back with a different one. Okay, so they start playing with it and opened it, and the bug that they found, it looked like, an 8-year-old science project or something. It was, and so they took pictures of it, and it was in all the newspapers, and actually a lot of people I spoke to sort of ridiculed them and said, like, seriously, that's ridiculous, that can't really be what the government is using against them, because it looked very simplistic. But if it works, it works. I don't think there's like any one technology we should be particularly worried about.
But thank you, I think that answered the question. But if you want to look at the specific technology that is being deployed, because I think that's kind of what your question was, like on the ground, what are we kind of trying to prevent?
Yeah, and more specifically, kind of what, I mean, what is the most worrying, I guess, evolution in technology? Not saying that it doesn't cost a lot to have these low-tech technologies, but more like trying to understand how this link between cost and technology and also marketing works together to be able to better assess what is the threats and where and how perhaps also in some cases I'm thinking of in the Netherlands that intelligence agencies are heavily understaffed and such. And so the fact that they can outsource some of the technology and can is a temptation as well, you know, gather more data, have less analysts. At the same time, it's perhaps also less efficient in terms of surveillance, even against activists. And so I'm not saying that we shouldn't be worried or at all about new surveillance technology. And more, my question is more, what type specifically of technology in your experience is what we should be more worried about, and if the question is relevant at all, because I'm not even sure my question is relevant. To be honest, I think it's
I think it's a good like academic exercise to kind of line them up. I think it's all there's a lot of technology. I wouldn't pinpoint like a data retention centers, but
yeah, I can give a few examples, but I'm sure Renato, you and Jochen also. But what we only know is that some Arab regimes basically had massive deep packet inspection routers on. Basically, all the internet was routed through just a few choke points. We have deep packet inspection that is on the high end of the sophistication investment scale. The hacking team was selling zero-day exploits to Ethiopian intelligence services, was using it for very attacks, spear phishing attacks on Ethiopian dissidents abroad, which in some ways is no less worrying because they were basically attacking not only, this wasn't only internal repression, there was repression of dissidents abroad. Both cases repression, both cases worrisome. But it is also, it's the Ethiopian intelligence service, which is not the most over-budgeted intelligence service on the planet, we can say, can afford to use to burn 0 days on dissidents. I can't really put my finger on a single technology here, I'm afraid. So I'm looking at.
I don't know if you've read the PI report, State of Surveillance. They do a pretty good job at detailing some of the things from Privacy International. Maybe check that out as a recommended reading. Cool. So I don't know if there's a last question perhaps in the audience or an intervention. You have looped back around. So please, and then we'll have a short answer and then we'll probably call it a day so you guys can get coffee.
Just a simple example that just leads me to a simple question. Maybe difficult to answer though, but there was a few, maybe a year or two ago, there were restrictions, I think, from the US towards Iran, which led for a certain amount of time for some apps on the Android and iPhone or Apple App Store markets to be banned in Iran, and like some VPN style applications and things like this were impossible to install or very hard to install on people's phones in Iran due to export control sort of. So what this example leads me to is how come up with criteria to avoid this, because this is exactly what we don't want. It's one of the things we really don't want.
But civil society as a whole is advocating to get crypto out of export controls completely. To address your specific example of VPNs not being available on our end, that has to do with the completely outdated idea of not allowing cryptography to be exported to certain bad countries.
Okay, but we can think definitely of other examples. For instance, on smartphones, you can have applications that are based on aircraft that anyone can use and can play around with looking at the security of their wireless network, for instance, and which could be very useful for local activists. I've seen people in Cairo use it. This is not really an export of cryptography. It's more of a pen testing tool.
That will be an example of.
So this is one thing you really don't want to forget, for instance.
Yeah, that's again like the nature of dual use and exactly you need to weigh again exactly what that end use will be. And that's yeah, I agree. That's exactly the type of technology.
But what I'm advocating with an Edry is I do not care so much for the technology. I do care much more for the services. If you're, for example, the aircraft technology on its, in itself is not that interesting, but if the Egyptian authorities were to put nodes with that technology every 100 meters in Cairo and have that implemented by a Western company, that to me at least is a valid concern and comes back to my earlier very strong statement. I don't care whether that's effective or not. I don't want companies from countries with democracy and rule of law to some extent, not enough, but still more than some others, to profit from that situation and then still be complicit in suppressing the development of that in other countries.
Right. Okay, I hope that answers the question. If not, then come up after. And I think I'm going to just give everyone like maybe a couple of seconds, 20, 30 seconds, just to summarize, you know, like a last kind of message to leave the wonderfully patient and inquisitive audience with from this discussion. And maybe we'll do reverse if we can start, Ellen, with like a recommendation or a takeaway, just to close up.
But recommendation, I think if you want human rights law really to be useful within the sector and the context, then we have to fundamentally rethink human rights and how it is organized and how we can involve both non-state actors, companies, but also not only focus on the domestic states as a duty bearer, but also the extraterritorial state obligations of states, what happens, you know, with companies that are vested in one state doing things abroad, how does the responsibility of that state, of the host state, come in as well? And that's a whole exercise that is ongoing, and then that's, you know, would help here as well.
Oh, it's just down the table. Okay, so, I mean, the fight against the human rights harms linked to surveillance is going to be a multi-pronged, multi-faceted, multi-dimensional, what have you, multi-fight, let's just put it that way. It's going to involve strategic litigation against unlawful programs in countries that operate them. It's going to involve trying to control the availability of some of these tools that lead to abuses in other countries and in our own. And it's going to involve people, you know, upping their games in terms of their own security. It's going to involve technologies designing more secure tech for us all to rely on. You know, this is a big fight, and it's going to take a lot of angles. The coalition that we're a part of, the Coalition Against Unlawful Surveillance Exports, you know, we're also against unlawful surveillance, period. And it's not a coalition about export regs, full stop. This is something that the EU, through the Commission, has taken the initiative to do. And that's great. We commend them for putting human rights, you know, on the agenda in that way. But we're totally clear that even this proposal, A, isn't going to solve the human rights problems linked to surveillance, and B, needs a lot of work before it does what it sets out to accomplish. So I think there are valid criticisms to make about the process, but I think we should be making those towards the existing process and trying to make this into as strong a piece of the puzzle as we can.
Thank you.
I've said enough so far.
You said enough?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can you do that? Okay.
Yes, I mean, my last thought would be that maybe we contribute much better to all countries, where in any country human rights are potentially abused, but this mass surveillance. So let's improve and increase security for all, and make very and increase the price and the difficulty for everyone to spy on.
I like that. That's a good note to end on. Okay, so maybe join me in thanking the panelists for their interventions. Thank you guys.